One of the things that makes shooting for HDR harder than shooting for SDR or the cinema is that a lot of production environments aren't conducive to monitoring your image in HDR. If you're a one-person DP shooter, it's pretty much impossible. While larger productions need a DIT and multiple delivery feeds to meet the needs of all crew members. Fortunately, whether monitoring in HDR is an option for you or not, you have available to you a whole suite of exposure tools that can help you craft superb HDR images. We're going to look at some of those tools today and how to use them in HDR in this video brought to you by SmallHD. I'm Sam with Billetto Services. I'm an independent filmmaker, colorist, and expert in video technologies, including HDR video. Today, we're going to look at four different exposure tools and learn how to interpret them when using HDR video signals, including camera log. I'm sure you're familiar with waveform monitors and how to read them in SDR. But indulge me a minute while I talk about how they work, because it sets the stage for how to read them in HDR. On a waveform monitor, the x-axis is the left-right axis of the image. The y-axis represents the signal intensity value of image elements found in each region of the image. And the brightness of the trace represents the number of pixels that land in that intensity region. In SDR, we know that our midtones land in the middle region of the signal. Our whites are at the top, and our darks are at the bottom. But that's not exactly how HDR works. For most camera signals, midtones land in the 15 to 30% range, whites in the 30 to 40% range, and speculars and ultra brights in the areas above that. Why is that? In our heads, we think of the y-axis as brightness, but it's not. It's the magnitude value of the signal, the data. In old analog terms, it was the intensity of the voltage, as a percentage of 100% reference, or 100 IRE, representing diffuse white. These signals were gamma-based, and so the middle tones landed in the middle of the trace. Whites 2.5 steps above the middle at the top, and blacks 3 steps below the middle at the bottom. Today, the IRE scale represents the percentage of the digital range used. Different camera log formats allocate exposure zones to different digital ranges, usually with the middle exposure low on the trace to allow for the extended log highlights. PQHDR has a similar distribution of values to log, and proper exposure for HDR signals shifts the waveform trace downwards. If you use your waveform monitor to expose for HDR, the same way you would for SDR, you'll almost always end up overexposing and clipping your highlights in the process. If you always use the same camera system, it's worth looking at the camera manufacturer's white paper for the log format you're using. They'll usually give you the IRE values for middle exposure, sometimes defined at different ISO values, and show you the distribution of dynamic range above your middle exposure. It'll take some time to get used to reading the waveform for your preferred log format, but it's worth the time investment. If you aren't fixed to one camera platform, it's still worth taking a peek at the white paper before running your shoot so you can see where your middle exposure lands. When monitoring in PQHDR, a lot of waveform monitors, like those found on SmallHD's HDR-aware displays, have the ability to change the scale from IRE or digital values to HDR's nits range. This takes most of the guesswork out of reading the scope. and when coupled with a spot meter, can give you great insights into contrast ratios within your image. Even if you don't reference the white paper or change your scale, you can still get a lot of useful information on a waveform monitor, especially when it comes to how you're retaining important highlight details for HDR. Look for the telltale horizontal lines that indicate you're clipping your highlights and adjust your exposure to retain the details if those are important to you. If you're using a full color waveform or an RGB parade, you should be able to see clear indication if one color channel is clipping before the others, which can result in hue shifts in HDR. One thing to be careful of is that most of your darks are going to be shifted low on your waveform monitors. Most log formats have a toe that prevents the signal from ever reaching zero, and you may be retaining 8 or more stops of dynamic range below your midtones into that toe. That doesn't mean you've lost detail in the darks, especially if you're shooting in RAW, 12-bit ProRes 444, or 12-bit DNX HR 444. It's tempting to adjust your exposure upwards to get a more even distribution on the waveform, but that's not actually beneficial in HDR, since it usually results in clipped highlights. Reading your histogram in HDR has a lot of the same benefits and cautions as reading your waveform monitor. Here, the x-axis gives you signal intensity information. The y-axis tells you how many pixels in the image have that intensity. Like the y-axis of the waveform monitor, the x-axis of the histogram is usually read out in IRE, and the meaning of the values depends on the format you're shooting in or the scope is monitoring in. If you're used to using a histogram, you may be used to looking at the histogram shape to tell you about the distribution of exposures in your image. Traditionally, a flatter histogram means you have a fairly even distribution between black and white. A center hump means that most of your content lands in the midtones, and peaks in the highs or lows tells you you've weighted brightly or darkly. In log and HDR, your histogram shapes are a little different, both because histograms scale the y-axis based on the distribution, and because most camera log formats and PQHDR are all low-weighted. A curve from the lows to the highs with a rapid fall off in the darks tells you you have an even distribution. A high peak in the middle lows tells you you have more midtones than brights or darks. High peaks above that tell you you have large, bright areas of the image or are overexposing. A vertical peak that doesn't rise when you adjust exposure usually indicates clipping somewhere in your image. High peaks in the lows usually mean that you're severely underexposing your image, and you're likely to be very deep into your noise floor. Waveform monitors and histograms typically give you similar kinds of information, but they do it differently. I found that the compactness of the histogram is a very fast way to check overall exposure and see if there are any problems at a glance. But it doesn't tell me where those problems are, which is when I turn to the waveform monitor. The spatial distribution and heat map lets me drill into how the camera is seeing the scene. Both are useful parts of the creative process. I'm going to talk about zebras and false color tools together, since they both work in a similar way. The idea here is to alter the image on your display in a way that reveals specific parts of the exposure. Zebras give you creeping lines over all bright areas above a threshold value, while false color tools assign a specific color to specific signal ranges, or a color gradient to the entire signal range. In SDR, zebras indicated parts of the image around 100 IRE, usually somewhere between 90 and 109 IRE, which is usually your diffuse white and speculars relative to your middle exposure. False colors typically use a few different shades to highlight different parts of the exposure range. The typical airy false color scale for SDR uses green and pink at the low and high end of SDR middle exposure, purple around signal black, with blue just above it, and red at signal peak, with yellow just below it. Once again, when working with HDR content, including camera log, the signal translates to different exposures than SDR, so our zebra and false color regions need to change. The threshold for zebras usually needs to come down to lower IRE values so that they indicate the scene's highlights captured by the camera log or a specific EV range above your middle exposure. When working in log, you may need to adjust the zebra's IRE when you change the camera's ISO, since ISO adjustments can affect where the camera clips above the middle exposure. The same thing goes with false color. Rather than simply using the default exposure highlighting ranges, you may need to shift the colors lower or higher to match the equivalent exposure region in your log image. One thing I like about the SmallHD line of displays is that when you're monitoring in PQHDR, the Waveform Monitor, Histogram, Zebras, and False Color tools all adapt to the HDR images. The scale becomes nits, and Zebras and False Color tools highlight nit ranges instead of IRE values. That's really useful when you're monitoring in HDR because it's one less level of abstraction you need to deal with. If you're sending your displays a log signal or sending a log signal to your scopes for exposure purposes, you'll benefit immensely from setting your own IRE range for zebras and false color tools. DITs should refer to manufacturer white papers to convert the signal ranges into the correct relative exposure values, either to match the airy false color look or to match the preferences of the cinematographer. If you're a single-person shooter operator, this is something you can set up using SmallHD's PageOS by setting up a few false color looks on the same page for the different camera platforms you work on or different camera ISO settings, and then triggering the correct look for any given shoot or setup. And with PageOS's ability to export your profile and move it to a different SmallHD display, you can bring that setup with you wherever you go. I'd like to thank SmallHD for sponsoring this video. Their versatile PageOS platform offers a whole suite of exposure tools that adapt their values to HDR, can be customized to your exact shooting preference and needs, and called up at your fingertips as you toggle between your personal preset pages. Whether you're monitoring in HDR or SDR, their exposure tools will help you capture the best HDR images for your intended look. Don't forget to check out my course on HDR, From Scene to Screen, the HDR Image Pipeline, and its forthcoming follow-up course, Advanced Shooting for HDR. In both courses, I go into detail about how to creatively think about HDR as a medium, just like we have for television and cinema. If you have any questions about exposure tools in HDR, leave them in the comments below. And of course, don't forget to subscribe to this channel for more tips, tricks, and tools for working in HDR. Until next time, I'm Sam Bilodeau, and I'll see you soon.